بعد وعلى آل محمد وبارك وسلم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم، أما بعد، قال الله تعالى في القرآن المجيد: لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة لمن كان يرجو الله واليوم الآخر وذكر الله كثيرا. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. If the brothers can remember, last week we were talking about how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had protected the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from all those things which were indecent. Anything that wasn't appropriate for a Prophet to do, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he protected the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from it. Anything that could later tarnish the splendor or the shan of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he totally protected and kept the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam away. And I had given a few narrations of how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had done this. And one of the most famous narrations was that once when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he had gone out of Makkah with one of his friends to graze the goats. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was with his friend and he told it, his friend, that I'm going to go back into Makkah and I'm going to listen to a few stories and I'll come back and I'll tell you. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he goes back into Makkah and he hears the noise of some music coming from a certain house. He enters the house, he asks what's going on, and they tell him that it was a wedding. And how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala amazingly, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he entered the house, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala amazingly, he put the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to sleep. And it was only in the morning when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he realized that all night I've been asleep. So this was something we were talking about last week. And last week I promised that inshallah, this week we're going to begin with the signs of Nubuwwat. What had happened just before the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was given prophethood by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now to begin with, we know that the word for a prophet in Arabic is Nabi. And the word Nabi, it comes from the word Naba'un. And the word Naba'un, this means that piece of news which is absolutely true, there's no doubt regarding it. And also at the same time, it is a very, very extremely important piece of news. So there's two aspects of this this word. One is that it is absolutely true, it doesn't have no doubt whatsoever. And the second thing is, it's extremely important. Now, the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam, Anbiya is the plural of Nabi. Now, why are the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam, why are they called Nabi? The reason is because these types of news, which are absolutely true and which are very, very important, they come to the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam. And they come from the unseen, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, there's two ways that these pieces of news, they can reach the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The first way is the way of divine revelation. Divine revelation as in wahi. This is the Arabic word for revelation. It is called wahi in Arabic. And this is the highest form of revealing the matters of the unseen to the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam. And the second is true dreams. And true dreams, these are the lowest form of revealing matters of the unseen, matters regarding Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, matters regarding the qabr. These are things that we cannot use our sensual perception, nor can we use our logic to know what is going on in the qabr, to know what is going on in Jahannam, to know about Jahannam, to know about Jannah. We can't use our logic, nor can we use our sensual perception to perceive these things. These things can only be given to us or taught to us through revelation. And now the two different types of revelation that I mentioned, one is the wahi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is divine revelation. This is the highest form of revealing ma'az to the prophets alayhi salatu wasalam. And the lowest form of revealing ma'az to the anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam, this is true dreams. Now when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he began getting closer and he approached closer to the time of actually being given prophethood, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he began showing the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam very, very true, extremely true dreams, and they'll be very, very clear. Now, in a hadith of Dalail Abi Nu'aym, Al-Qama ibn Qais, he was a student of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he was a tabi'i. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud was sahib al-na'alayn, he would carry the shoes of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the sandals of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was extremely close to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Al-Qama ibn Qais, he was one of the top students of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. Now Abdullah ibn Mas'ud in Dalail Abi Nu'aym, he narrates a hadith, he says, When the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam, when they get closer to their time of being given prophethood, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he begins showing them true dreams through which their heart becomes content. Now once their heart, he goes on to say, once their heart becomes content with these true dreams, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he showers amongst them upon them revelation from the heavens, which comes upon these people, and because they've been seeing these true dreams, now they're able, they're strong enough, their heart is at a condition where it can actually endure the weight of this wahi. So it's exactly like Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. If we see that just before Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, he was given prophethood by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what does he see? He sees a dream of the sun. He sees a dream of the moon and 11 stars, like we had mentioned last week, that they were prostrating to him. He says, Ya abati inni ra'aytu ahad ashara kawkaban wa shamsa wal qamara ra'aytuhum li sajidin. That I see the O Father, I seen 11 stars, I seen the sun and I seen the moon, and they were prostrating to me. So this was a true dream that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made evident and made apparent later on in his life. But it was shown to him before Nubuwwat, why? Just to sort of give tasalli, to comfort his heart for the coming things that were going to happen. Now, like I said, that the dreams of the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam, they are absolutely true. They are like wahi, like revelation is true. Similarly, the dreams of the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam, they are exactly true. This is the aqeedah of the Ahli Sunnah wal Jamaat, that whatever a Nabi he sees in his dreams, this is absolutely true. There is no possibility of a lie. Coming on to the dreams of the awliyaullah, those close friends of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who see dreams, what is the ruling regarding their dreams? The ulama, they say that the siddiqeen, the awliyaullah, their dreams, majority of the times their dreams are true. They will see dreams that are true, but they will not be as clear as the dreams of the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam. I'll be mentioning how clear the dreams of the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam are. So the dreams of the Siddiqeen, the dreams of the Awliyaullah, they are absolutely true. They'll be true majority of the times, 80-90% of the times they'll be true. But sometimes they can be illusions which are being created by the subconscious mind. So if an Awliyaullah, a Wali of Allah, he does see a dream, there is a possibility, yes, that it can be true, but there is also a possibility that it's just an illusion that has been created by his subconscious mind. In Muslim Sharif, there's a hadith that أصدقهم رؤيا أصدقهم حديثا. Subhanallah. The meaning of the hadith is the more truthful a person is in his speech, the more truthful his dream will be. As in, the more truth that you speak through your daily, day-to-day life, the more truth that you speak, when you go to sleep, even then your dreams will be just as truthful. See, Allahu Akbar, how much of an effect your truth, in your daily life, it can have an effect to the extent that it has an effect on your dreams. The truth of your dreams is based on how truthful you are throughout your day. It has such an effect that, the effect of your truth, speaking truth to people, it comes upon your face. In a hadith, when Hazrat Abdullah ibn al-Salam, just before he had become Muslim, Hazrat Abdullah ibn al-Salam radiallahu ta'ala, he was one of the Jewish rabbis that had become a Muslim. So he says that when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was coming into Medina, he says that I was on top of a tree, and he says that I was looking at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam entering Medina. He says that as soon as I seen the face of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I understood that this is not the face, this cannot be, sorry, this cannot be the face of a liar. This is how much of a, you know, a effect that, you know, when we speak truth, this is how much of an effect it has, that it actually shows upon our face. You know, you hear people say that, you know, this person, you know, he's got the face of a liar. Why? Because it shows on his face. The Nuraniyat is killed when he speaks a lie. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the Quran, لَعْنَةُ اللَّهِ عَلَى الْكَاذِبِينَ, that may the curse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be on those people that speak lies. Why? It takes away the Nuraniyat. That Nuraniyat that was building inside a person's heart, that spirituality that was building inside a person's heart through his salah, through his zikr, through his Quran, through his fasting, all that, when the minute he says or speaks a lie, that person's Ruhaniyat, it all goes down, and this also has an effect. Why does it have an effect on the face? It's because these a'mal that we do throughout the day, each and every single amal, it has a nur inside, it has a light. Now, this light, every time we carry out these actions, this light, it builds inside our heart. It builds. So, to the extent that a time comes where your whole heart, it becomes filled with nur. Now, after it becomes filled with nur, that nur has nowhere else to go apart from inside and spread into your body. Once it spreads inside a person's body, then it begins shining on a person's body parts. You'll see that person's body parts, his hands, his face, all his limbs, they'll have a shine to him. Now this shine is the nur that is pouring out of his heart, which has been created by the a'mal that he's doing. But when this person, he begins to lie, this nur, it decreases and it begins to sort of eradicate, it begins to sort of fade away. So that this is the effect that a person's zaban, a person's tongue, it can have on him, that it can sort of take away the nuraniyat, the light of his face. And we can see that how this light, it comes about, we can see from the hadith of Abdullah ibn Salam, radiyallahu ta'ala. So, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he sort of got closer towards his time of being given Nubuwwat, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he begins seeing